My name's Officer Wallace. I'm the school resource officer for the Northampton Police Department. So my job is basically to be in the schools and help out the kids and the staff and anything around that. And through the summer, I do the same thing, working with juveniles and trying to keep them out of trouble. So one of the big things we can do to keep the kids out of trouble is to educate them, and not only educate them, but educate their parents, because most of the time they're better at speaking to their own kids than we are. So it's a lot easier for us to do programs like this. I usually do this with a partner, Adam Van Buskirk. He's not here. He has a dog emergency, so he's in Deerfield with his dog getting emergency surgery on it. So he is really sorry he couldn't be here, but he's got things he takes care of. And I tell you that just to let you know that we are human. We have other things outside of being a police officer in our lives, so, you know, bear with us. Like karate, I have class tonight, yeah. So when I put together this PowerPoint, I tried to make it as entertaining for not only kids but parents, and to kind of match my sense of humor. So the first thing we always get when we get called to parties is, you know, how'd you find me? Or how'd you find out we were here? Or, you know, the first question is, dude, how'd they find us? A lot of the times we'll get noise complaints. We will get someone calling saying there's a group of kids, they look underage, and I see them with alcohol, or I see them with this, I see them with that, and they're going into this place, and that's one of the ways we find parties. Suspicious behavior, you know, there is a lot of us driving around. The way Northampton's broken up is there's four areas. Each area has its own patrol car assigned to it. Then we have a person walking downtown, and if we have anyone else working, they're auxiliary cars. So there are plenty of police officers driving around Northampton. So when we're driving around and we see a big group of cars parked somewhere that there normally isn't, that usually draws our attention, and we'll start paying attention to that area. Medical calls, we recently have had a couple parties where we have had juveniles so intoxicated that they're unconscious. So we've actually had kids call 911, and one of the scariest part of that is they tell everyone at the party we're going to call 911, so they wait for everyone to leave that doesn't want to be there when the police or ambulance get there. So that's time taken away from this person who's unconscious. And that's really scary to us, because we know that they're going to wait and notify everyone, hey, the cops are coming, you know, get everything, get out of here, get your car out of here, we're going to call 911. And then some of them will stay and wait. And, you know, we'll get there, and it's been 10, 15 minutes since they should have called. Or an investigation into another incident. We've had OUIs where we stop kids driving away from parties. We've had fights at different locations and things like that. And then once, you know, while we're investigating, they'll say, oh, we were at Joe's house. You know, he's having a party. And we will go to Joe's house to see what the party's all about. So there's different ways that we find out. A lot of the stuff we do now, especially in my job, because every kid's life is on social media. I do monitor social media pretty heavily. Twitter, you know, the Periscope, the Facebook Live, all that. If you're not used to using it, and I'm not very social media savvy, but I just went to a class the other day that makes Facebook very scary. So even more reason for me not to have a Facebook account. But, you know, with Facebook Live and everything like that, if you're transmitting on Facebook Live, all I have to do is open up the Facebook Live map, look to where someone's Facebook Living, you know, zoom into my area and click and see what you're transmitting. And then I can record that video. I can geolocate that video. I can do all things like that. I can get into your blocked accounts in about 3 minutes. So it's really scary to what's on there. Snapchat, the stories. One of the biggest misconceptions for youth these days, and it ends up, you know, driving us crazy, is, you know, the Snapchat thing where they take a picture and it's gone in like 10 seconds, but it's not really gone. Snapchat stores it, and when you send a Snapchat, there's people taking screenshots of it, or they have another phone or an iPod and they take a picture of their phone, so that picture you sent is now saved somewhere else. When they send something out, it's out. Like, it doesn't come back. There's a great little snippet or a PSA where the girl has a picture of herself on the wall. She goes and rips it down, you know, in the high school, and it's of her, you know, in like a bathing suit. She doesn't like it. She rips it down. The picture pops back up, and people just keep walking by, ripping the picture down, showing it to everybody else. And she comes by, and she keeps trying to rip it down. That's how it is. As much as, you know, kids want to believe they can put stuff out there and then it disappears, it doesn't. It doesn't disappear, and it, you know, we end up finding it. Through a lot, you know, sometimes it takes a little bit, sometimes it takes some investigation, a lot of report writing, but we get the information we need to get. So like I said, I tried to break it down so people understand how Northampton is broken down. Sometimes when I go to the community events and I talk to people, they'll say, oh, I see a cop all the time, or there's always, you know, there's always a cop here, or there's never a cop in this area. So the way it's broken down is on the weekend, there's a 7-officer minimum for the shifts, which means we have the 4 officers that I told you about, a walking guy, a guy working the desk, and then we have an extra guy who's always driving around. So like I said, that's the 4 area cars, 1 desk officer, 2 Main Street officers. But what they'll usually do is take one of those Main Street officers and put them in a car. And then if it gets busier, they'll take the other Main Street officer and put them in a car. We always have someone walking downtown. If it's 4 o'clock in the morning and you're downtown, there is someone walking around. It's just something we've done historically, and there's nothing we can do to get rid of it. As boring as it is at 4 o'clock in the morning walking around, we're out there. If it's raining or stuff, they may be nice enough to give us a car, but most of the time we're on foot walking around downtown. So typically 2 officers will be sent to a call. That's because there's going to be more than 1 person there. That's just for our safety and everyone else's safety, to make sure that if 1 officer is talking to everyone involved, that the other one is making sure that the scene is safe and that everyone is safe and no one's doing anything bad. It could be more. It depends on the initial call. What this means, if you look at the top where we have 4 officers, say we have 7 officers working, that's 6 on the street. 2 officers at your house for a call, that's only 4 officers left on the street to cover, you know, however, what, 32.3 square miles, I think Northampton is, with about 32,000 residents. So on a busy Friday night with everything else going on, or Saturday night, we have 2 officers at your house for an average, I think the average was about 60 minutes for us to be at a house for a party. And that's because of how we handle things. So typically when we get there, we will observe the area very briefly. It could be just while we're driving up, but we're looking around, making sure what we see is, you know, we can see. We look for cars leaving the area with too many kids in them. You know, the Honda Civic with 7 kids sitting on each other's laps, trying to get out of the area as fast as they can. Because let's face it, we know how it was. We went to high school. So the cops roll up, someone calls and says, yo, the cops are coming, and everyone starts flooding out of the house, and everyone piles into someone's car because they got to get out of there. We see that, you know. youths flee the party without a proper attire. We have that a lot, especially around this time of year, where it's nice. It's like 40, almost 50 during the day. You might be at someone's house, you know, if you're drinking or doing something else. Your body starts to heat up, so you're nice and warm. Then the cops show up and you're like, oh, I gotta go. You run out and you're in your shorts and a t-shirt and maybe no shoes, and you run into the woods, and all of a sudden, an hour later, it's 32 degrees. You're wet because it's raining like this, and your body temperature is just dropping. So, you know, at such a rapid pace that you're at risk for hypothermia and a lot of other medical issues. But that's, you know, it's what we pay attention to. We try to minimize. And through this education program, and, you know, even talking to kids, I try to get it so that they don't run away from the party. It's not that bad to stay. You're not going to get in trouble. You're going to be identified. You're going to have to call your parents. That's what we do. But you're not going to get criminal charges, barring any, you know, really odd circumstances. So we'll approach the house. Sometimes what you get is the kids who watch too much YouTube or too much NCIS or SVU or anything like that, and I need a warrant to, you know, the first words out of the mouth, you can't come in here because you need a warrant. All I need is to be able to see someone I believe to be under the age of 21 and to see alcohol in order to enter your house. So if the attendees appear to be underage, or you identify someone who's under 21, say an OUI or something outside of the house, and you identify someone who's under 21 and they said they came from this house, I put this, you know, this case law, you can look it up. You know, for us, that means a lot. For normal people, that's like jumble. But that law, that case law just says that we can enter because we believe evidence of a crime may be destroyed. And the riotous and continuing noise at the time of the police entry. If we show up, the music's really loud, we say turn it down, you say no, we have a noise complaint that we're responding to, or whatever it is, we can justify entering your house to say they weren't going to turn the music down. Or if we leave and they turn it back up, then we can enter to end the music so that we don't get another noise complaint. So once we get in the house and we do encounter kids, a lot of them is, oh my God, am I going to get in trouble for this? So the alcohol violations in minors under 21 years of age. Minors may not possess or transport alcohol anywhere except on property controlled by the parent or guardian or in the company of the parent or guardian. So that means at your house, if you're with your parents' permission, yes, you may drink alcohol. But alcohol may not be consumed in public or in an open container, and your friends can't drink.
Isn't that illegal?
Huh?
Illegal?
So you can give your own son or daughter alcohol,
yeah, I thought that was illegal.
But you can't get them drunk because then you're putting them in child endangerment. You could let them have a beer if you wanted to, but the second somebody else takes a sip of that or there's another kid present, you're furnishing alcohol to a minor. Don't worry, it gets even better with marijuana. And I did add some slides for marijuana on this.
They run away because they have like scholarships, like college scholarships and stuff, and if they're found to be in the company of alcohol or whatever, they're going to lose their scholarships and stuff. So like people like leave.
So that's why we're out educating people. So that, you know, I'll get into that. So again, more getting into trouble for this. The question brought up was, she said that she watches a lot of SVU. And that she sees that a lot of, you know, on the movies and stuff, that a lot of kids run away from parties because they have scholarships for athletics. And if they're caught in the presence of alcohol or anything like that, they could lose their scholarship. So the way we're, this school or this area, Massachusetts in general, athletics are governed by MIAA rules. MIAA says you must possess, you cannot possess tobacco products, alcohol, or narcotics. It does not say you cannot be in the presence of them. So if you're an athlete at a party and you're just there, you're not going to get in trouble. But if you're an alcohol at a, if you're an athlete at a party, you possess alcohol, or you are intoxicated at a party, or you possess narcotics, or even if you're smoking cigarettes, and the police officer in the report writes that Joe Jones was, you know, was compliant, but he, you know, he stood outside smoking a cigarette while he was waiting for his mother. When I bring the report to school, that could be result in a suspension from sports. It does jeopardize people's scholarships, and that's why we're trying to educate athletes and stuff about the use and being around alcohol and not putting themselves in that situation in the first place.
MIAA is very, very strict about their regulations, and they don't care what the city regulations or state regulations are. And I have seen them jam up kids for being present at a party with alcohol. Within the last 6 years. So it can depend on what the teen's rules are and if the teen's rules were violated. But my opinion of MIAA is they convict first and worry about it later. It's kind of like our bar association. You're guilty and then you can prove yourself innocent. MIAA is someone to be fearful of, I see. I find them to be very, very strict, and we get calls all the time in my office. I work in the DA's office. So the message is, if you're going to be part of a team, you have a duty to your teammates to follow the rules and to not be at a party with these substances. Because MIAA will step in and you don't want to put your team at risk. It's one thing if you put yourself at risk, but we get calls a lot from parents who are complaining about it, but often there's no charges that come to us.
Right.
And so I've heard a lot of criticism of MIAA. I'm not them. They may want to speak to that, but that's another way you can talk to your kids and say they have a duty to their teammates to make sure they follow the rules.
So my experience here dealing with our athletic director, when I bring her a report, she'll say that, oh, they have to be, because I, so a lot of the officers that I work with will think, well, I wrote everyone that was in the report and they were there present at the party. Doesn't that mean that they're going to get in trouble? Because, you know, let's face it, cops don't want to arrest or charge kids with crimes that they don't have to. We don't want to ruin someone's life. We really don't, despite, you know, what happens or the image of us, you know, talking about Northampton Police. I can't speak for East Hampton or anyone else, but the guys I work with don't want to ruin someone's life. So they won't charge a kid just for being at a party or being in possession of alcohol or anything like that, unless there's some other mitigating circumstances. So what they'll do is they'll write the report saying that this kid was there, and they'll hand it to me, and then I'll go back to them and say, well, were they drinking? No, they were there, though. Doesn't that mean they're going to get in trouble at school? And they think that that's punishment enough, is getting suspended from sports or getting spoken to by school. You know, the police officers believe that that's punishment enough. And I've brought reports to the athletic director and had her say, no, they have to be in possession. I can't do anything with them being present. MIAA doesn't say anything about that. So if they're getting people for being present, then all power to them, because, again, when I talk to athletes and they're like, I wasn't, you know, I was there, but I wasn't drinking. I'm like, why were you even there? Why even put yourself in this situation? You know, why even have it questioned? You're looking at a scholarship. I've had, you know, star athletes. I'm like, you're looking at a scholarship, right? Yeah. I'm like, why even jeopardize it? You could cost yourself $80,000, $20,000 a year at a school that's willing to give you that just to come play a sport for you, for them. You're willing to jeopardize that over a beer, over a joint, over whatever, you know, over a hit, you know, that's what you're gonna lose this all over, you know, and just being present may not actually violate the rules, so may not have the school report them, but there may be other schools that will report them to MIAA and just say, you do what you want to do with them, and MIAA may hand down the suspension. You know, I know coaches that just being present at a party will result you in being suspended from their program, but as a coach. It's a coach's suspension. It's not an MIAA suspension. So it looks like it varies, you know, maybe school to school, but I know MIAA is very strict, and our athletic director is pretty strict. She doesn't care who you are. If she gets a report that says you were in possession of something, or if you were caught on school grounds smoking, or even in possession of vape liquid that has a nicotine level, you're suspended. So going back to the social host laws, the furnishing alcohol occurs when a person supplies or allows alcohol to be consumed by a minor. This charge is for any host of an underage drinking party. That can be your own kid, even if they're a teenager. So if your 18-year-old throws a party and there's booze there, they could be charged with furnishing alcohol to a minor just for hosting the party. And procuring by false pre-representation, those are the ones that go into liquor stores, say I'm 21, when they're not really, or they go somewhere else and say, you know, I'm 21, or if you tell a police officer, I'm 21, I just forgot my license at home. My name's this, my birth date's that, and it's their sister or their cousin or something along those lines. So again, I can only speak to what Northampton Police do. So that's why the title is, this is the Northampton Police. Our response is an effort, again, to educate, inform, and deter alcohol use. So what we'll do is we'll collect the evidence. We may take photos to document damage. If there's like a large amount of alcohol, we'll take photos of that. If there's any narcotics or anything else suspicious, we'll take photos. We'll identify everyone there. We are now getting in the habit of bringing a PBT to parties and PBTing every single person under the age of 18. It's a portable breath test. So we can accurately measure the amount of alcohol in your blood system before we let you go. And the reason that is because what we're seeing now at parties is a lot of kids are not drinking. They're smoking marijuana or they're doing other drugs. We'll note if you're under the age of 18, we'll notify your parents. The parents must come pick them up, and we'll only release them to a responsible adult after speaking with the officer who's on scene.
So we won't release you to a friend or a friend's mom or a cousin or anything like that. We want your parent to come pick you up 2-3 o'clock in the morning. We will call you. I've called people at Stowe, Vermont when they were away, you know, on like a nice weekend away. I've called them and said, you need to come and come pick your kid up. I mean, you know, or figure it out. And if they don't, then there's a, you know, there's a possible DCF involvement for neglect. So our first choice, even our second or third choice, is never to arrest a kid. Unless there's less some other mitigating circumstances. Protective custody, and I should have changed this slide because now we can place you in protective custody for narcotics. But again, it's the same standard. They must be incapacitated due to liquor. It used to be not drugs. Recently, it was switched to drugs. But most likely, we will send you to the hospital. So protective custody, we have three options. We can either send you home, take you to the police station, or send you to the hospital. If you're a minor and you're going to be placed in protective custody, you will be sent to the hospital. There is no home or the station. Because if you're that intoxicated, you know, where you're incapacitated, then it's a medical emergency. We need to get you there. So is DCF going to be involved? When a youth is at a party and a phone call is placed to the parents, if they refuse to pick up or refuse to make arrangements with a responsible adult, also if there's a safety concern. So, you know, we have been to parties where it's like, you got to call your parents. I can't call my parents. I'm never calling my parents. You know, they'll beat me more than they usually do. We're like, wait a second, more than you usually do? Come over here, we need to talk. You know, so that's when we would notify DCF. Just because your kid's at a party and you may not know, or, you know, we've had parents who are like, oh, I knew Johnny was going to have a couple friends over. I didn't know it was going to be 30 kids with alcohol and weed. You know, we won't notify DCF because of that. We'll write a report, we'll refer it to everything, we'll talk to you a little more. You know, if there's something like, yeah, I knew he was having friends over, I knew they were drinking, I told him to stay at the house, well, that's a little different than I knew he was going to have some friends over, I didn't know it was going to be this big. Can it really be that bad? This is just items I've found. I've heard of other stuff found at parties, but I've gone into parties where they're lighting fireworks off inside the house. I've found loaded handguns, loaded shotguns. I had a kid pull a shotgun out of a closet when we came into the house. I had a kid take a broomstick and try to attack us like a Ninja Turtle. I found other narcotics, prescription medication. It's a little scary sometimes what we see when we go into houses with a bunch of intoxicated kids. You know, they're kids. Their judgment is already not the best. And I mean that in all the respect for every kid in this room. But your brain's not done developing until you're aged around 24, 25. Scientific studies, there's nothing you can do to increase your how fast your brain develops. Your prefrontal cortex, I call it the stupid filter. It's the very front of your brain. It's that part of your brain that says, this probably isn't a good idea. I'm not going to do this. That isn't done. That's the last thing that gets developed. So, you know, anything, alcohol, marijuana, other narcotics that interferes with that while your brain is developing has long-lasting and forever effects. So it's really scary going into these youth parties and finding some of this stuff that could seriously hurt somebody. And having kids who are already not fully, you know, aware of consequences, but now their, you know, inhibitions are lowered because of alcohol or narcotics. A lot of the recent trends we've been seeing at parties is cocaine use is up. Xanax, the kids call this the life reset pill. They'll take Xanax, drink a little bit, blackout, be totally awake and everything, but not remember anything that happened that entire night. They use Adderall.
Xanax does that?
Yep. Don't go home and try it.
No, is it just Xanax or is it Xanax and alcohol?
Well, Xanax and alcohol, the combination of it. marijuana, a lot of the edibles, and then, you know, driving concerns under marijuana. A lot of us parents, I am a parent myself, have taught, you know, my kids are only 6 and 8, so I haven't taught them not to get in cars with drunk people yet because I don't know many 8-year-olds that are drinking and driving. But when they get older, a lot of us have that talk. If you're going to be at a party, don't get in a car with someone who's drunk because it's, you know, I don't want to see you on the news. I don't want to lose you. I care too much about you. Not many of us are having that conversation with, don't get in the car with someone who smoked with marijuana. It's a lot stronger than alcohol. So what we ask is you talk to them. You're better communicating with your kids than we are. You know them. You know their lifestyle. You know how to speak with them. You've gotten them to where they are now. You're able to do that better than we are. So most know not, again, most know not to get in a car with someone who's been too drunk, not to drive if they've been drinking. What they need to learn is don't take a pill if you're not prescribed the pill. How to judge if someone's high, it's just as bad, sometimes worse, as being intoxicated on alcohol. Travel in groups, and that one drink could be too much for you to drive.
What do you mean by high, like marijuana or all types of drugs?
Marijuana. I have a chart in here. I'll show you the increase in THC level that marijuana's taken. It's gone from this, you know, pretty similar to the effects of a beer to you're looking at super psychological effects of marijuana. It's a really strong psychoactive drug now. The one thing I do ask parents is that if your kids go out to a party and we do get called, or if they come home and there was an issue, the way we are teaching parents to deal with it is bring them in the house, make sure they're safe, talk to them in the morning. Don't be angry, don't be mad, don't be upset. They're kids, they made a mistake. Talk to them in the morning when you're cooled down and they're sober. All right?
Do you have those contracts that, I don't know, when I was a teenager, my dad signed a contract saying that no matter where I was, if I couldn't get home because somebody had been drinking, he was going to come get me, no questions asked, you won't talk till the morning?
But yeah, that's what I'm asking. I don't make a contract.
There was an actual contract that my school sent me, and that my dad signed, which I was shocked that he would.
Yeah. I mean, it's a good idea, and that's just what we're asking is if your kid's in trouble, if your kid comes home or your kid, you know, the police call and you have to go pick your kid up, don't be mad at them. They're a kid. They made a mistake. You're an adult. You've made mistakes before in your life. We all have. We're understanding as police officers on scene. We just ask that you be understanding of your kids at the same time. Deal with it in the morning. Obviously, there's going to be repercussions for this. You know, I don't expect any parent to just let it go. Nor would I ask you to, but we just want you to be compassionate at that time. It builds a lot more trust with your kids. They'll be more open to share things with you. They'll be more open to call you if there's a problem, and that's what we want, is we want them to call someone if there's a problem. You know, there's a lot of kids that are afraid to call 911 when their friend's too drunk because they don't want to get in trouble. So the only way we can fix that is through education and talking to kids and saying, you're not going to be in trouble. This is the worst thing that's going to happen is we're going to call your mom. But your friend needs medical treatment and you need to get some help. We've actually had people who have had they've been at a party, someone got too drunk, they drove them to somebody else's house and then called 911. You know, and this is a medical emergency. You know, these people were unconscious. When we got there, the girl was unconscious. She had to be transported rapidly to the hospital because she was so intoxicated. But they didn't want to get anyone else in trouble. They didn't want to get in trouble. They didn't want to lose their peer support group. So they put her in a car, drove her to somebody else's house. We showed up there, and this was a bunch of athletes hanging out together when a really drunk girl just showed up at her house. We got called. We came in there, identified everyone, and all these athletes are now getting called into the athletic director's office for being at a party. But it wasn't really a party. They were at someone's house hanging out, but these kids drove a really drunk girl up there knowing there'd be a group of kids there, and they could call 911, and it'd be safe for them to come in and deal with her. The biggest repercussions is... for kids is the social media, the pictures that are out there, the embarrassment of people sharing what happened to you at the party over social media. Again, it doesn't go anywhere. The rumors, you know, while you were at the party, this happened. Guess what happened to this person at that party? You know, rumors aren't always true, but they do get spread pretty fast. Girls are open to sexual assault, and again, the school discipline in sports. The sexual assault numbers. That's one of my biggest concerns is my graduating seniors going off to college. That's when a lot of sexual assaults happen. It's on the rise. It's something that we can only do through education, is to go and take care of yourself while you're at college, because, you know, this stuff happens. So marijuana. So marijuana at the present time is much stronger than your father's weed. If you look at this chart in 1972, the THC level was at a 1. In 2008, it's at a 6. I think now it's at like 8. So that's, you know, you're looking at 8 times the amount of THC in marijuana nowadays. And the reason we get that is because we're better farmers now. You know, we add stuff to our soil, we grow things better. You know, back in 1972, they planted it in the woods and they just let it grow like a weed. Now they have hydroponic systems and UV lights and all kinds of nutrients that they're injecting into the soil, and they're getting, you know, this super weed, you know, for lack of better terminology. And THC is the psychological aspect, you know, what affects your brain and your judgment and everything. And it's so much stronger than it used to be. So if you look at your brain, the colored part is what is really affected. And that yellow part, that's your stupid filter. That's the stuff that keeps you from doing the things that are going to hurt you or cause problems or anything like that. So the way I explain it is your brain starts out like this, a simple dirt road. When you're a kid, your brain's a simple dirt road. If you think, you look at kids nowadays, sorry Serenity, but this is how it is. Your brain is a dirt road. It's simple, it's rough to get through sometimes, there are some bumpy spots, it's not real easy to navigate. Through education and normal development, it turns into a two-lane paved road. Then what's supposed to happen is a thing called myelination. Myelination is when your brain takes this fatty sheath and wraps it around your axons, which is your brain cells. And what it does is it helps the brain waves to move faster, your thoughts and everything to move faster with less restriction, less resistance. So everything, your brain works a lot better after myelination. So your brain works like this. It takes what you have as a two-lane road. And when it comes through to go to myelinate, it's trying to turn it into this, a nice four-lane road. But when your brain comes through, and if you've been using alcohol, marijuana, or any other drugs, that all attaches to your receptors in your brain. So when your brain comes through like a detail crew, and that's why I had the picture of the construction guys up there, when it comes through like a detail crew, it goes to your normal brain cells and says, we're going to myelinate this section today. And then when they go out there and they look, and if it has THC attached to it or alcohol or anything else, it fools them into saying, oh, we already did this one, move on to the next road. So they move on and they myelinate that section of the brain. The problem is they don't ever come back to fix that other section. So your portions of your brain will actually not develop properly because of the use of alcohol while your brain's, or alcohol, marijuana while your brain's developing. I know it's legal now. Cheech and Chong. So the law says, the new law says, you can sell or possess any amount. The law says you may not sell or possess to sell any amount, and that the punishment, the most serious punishment, is you could be arrested for it. So you can't sell it. You can gift it, but there's very specific rules as to what a gift is, and pretty much any time you gift marijuana, you're selling it. A gift over an ounce to an adult, which is someone over 21, is arrestable, and you may not grow marijuana outside your primary residence. That's arrestable. But as far as kids go, the 21 years and under is what is illegal now. And I thought I put it in here, but apparently I didn't. Oh, there it is. With the alcohol law, there was the social host aspect where you could let your kid drink, but you couldn't let anyone else's kid drink. With marijuana, there is no social host aspect written into this law. So what does that mean? That you may not gift or transfer any marijuana to a minor 21 in any amount, anywhere, regardless of the relationship, or you could be arrested for dealing marijuana. Like I put in there, it's different than the social host for alcohol. There's no provisions in the law. So what we're left as police officers is to charge you with dealing marijuana. So you could be at home and give your kid a beer, But you even let them take a hit off the joint, and you're dealing marijuana, and you could be charged with that. Marijuana in vehicles?
That seems to be the rage, like the sitting with your child, your minor child, and like smoking marijuana. Like, I've seen that, I've heard of it. It's just bizarre.
Well, because now that it's legal to smoke.
Well, this wasn't when it was legal, but right. Yeah.
Well, the problem is now it's legal to smoke, but it's not legal to smoke outside. It's not legal to smoke in your car. It's only legal to smoke in your house or on your property, and if you're over 21. If you're in a vehicle, the alcohol standards for open container apply to the marijuana, but the standards written into the law for alcohol is that the factory seal must still be intact.
There is no factory seal for marijuana. Just because it's in a Ziploc bag and it's sealed, it's an open container, and you're subject to a $500 local fine.
Any amount of marijuana in your car could be given a local citation for open container.
Well, there's a change of law about the smell. You can't go up to a car if it smells.
So it started off when I first started being a police officer. It started off if I smelt marijuana, I could tear the car apart, and if I found a seed, I could lock you up. You know, the smallest little bit, I could lock you up. Then it started with, well, you could look for any other marijuana, you know, to try to prove that the person was dealing, you know, marijuana. And then what happened was the freshly burnt marijuana was taken away from us, the odor of freshly burnt marijuana, so we could only look for the raw marijuana. And then it was, or maybe vice versa, but then raw marijuana smell was taken away from us. Now it's even if we, whatever we see in the car, we can take, but if we don't openly see it and recognize it as marijuana, we can't search your car.
I thought it was.
Oh, they stink. But yeah.
I don't even know how people think they're going to get away with it.
I think the reason is because if someone smoked other than the driver in the car, you'd still smell it. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So like say I'm driving three people and one kid in the back smokes, it's going to seem like everybody smells, you know? I'm just saying through their eyes.
So if we stop you and your car smells like marijuana, we're going to pull you out and do field sobriety tests on you. But we can still prove intoxication.
So like the field sobriety works for marijuana?
It works for marijuana only because of the way we're testing. We're not testing you for alcohol. We're testing you for your reaction, your balance, your stuff.
Exactly.
So if we can prove that you're under the influence at any level, you're under arrest. There is no minimal level of marijuana. So even like secondhand smoke, because someone else smoked in the car and you're feeling it a little bit, if we can prove that, you're under arrest for OUI.
I thought it was like, oh, why are you pulling me over? Because I smoked weed. I thought that was me.
We can't do that. We have to have a motor vehicle violation.
Yeah, that's what I was asking. Because I heard that it's in the law.
You know how with alcohol, it's very neat. It's like, you know, your liver processes one alcohol drink per hour, and then you know how many hours later the person is no longer intoxicated or whatever. Is there anything like that with marijuana?
No, because that's not true for alcohol either.
It's not.
It's not true at all. I worked in a hospital. What happens is your body type, my body type. If you and I have the same glass of wine at dinner, I could process it faster, I could process it slower. It all depends on our body type. There are some people who can't process alcohol at all. Eskimos, Asian backgrounds have a difficulty processing alcohol. So your body, there is a medical standard that says, you know, for so many hours you should fall down this, but that's not true, because we could PC you, we could place you in protective custody, we know you haven't had a drink, and we could test you 1 hour and then test you 1 hour later and your blood alcohol level could go up. So it's, you know, the medical, like, oh, I had a beer, I have to wait 4 hours before I can drive. It's not like swimming, you know, because you eat, you have to wait a half hour to jump in the pool.
That's the meat package they sold us when, you know, like when we were a part of MAD and stuff, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like...
There is some truth to it. I shouldn't say it's totally
so
wrong.
Like, as far as, like, but, marijuana, I have no clue, like, you know...
And you know what? Neither do we.
Kid smoked something, how many hours, and then can they drive, and all that. So it's, like, sort of deceptive because, you know, that's... How do you teach your kid, you know? I guess... The safest thing is like if they've been smoking at all, not to get in the car at all.
Correct.
Not to get in the car.
Think about it. Kids aren't experienced drivers. We have to share the roads with everybody. If you're going to get behind the wheel of a car, you're going to share the road with a newer driver. And if they have some level of impairment, that doesn't make them a better driver. And that can be a danger. So any kind of impairment, if they're getting behind the wheel, can affect their ability to drive. We have a lot of experience as older folks driving in bad, heavy rain, driving at night, mm-hmm. driving in blizzards, driving in snow. Those are the things that they have to learn. And Officer Wallace is correct in that we're not sure exactly. There's no easy formula as to how a drug will affect you, alcohol or marijuana. There is a formula, but there's so many other variables. What's your weight? How often do you drink or ingest this drug? Do you have another medical condition that may affect it? Things like diabetes or thyroid condition.
What did you eat recently?
What did you eat?
That's, I mean, that's the thing. They tell us about alcohol, but like with marijuana, I have no idea what would be safe. Like, let's say your brain surgeon said to do surgery on you on Monday, and if they're doing, like, this is my whole problem with it being legal, is like, what if they smoked over the weekend? How many hours between them smoking, do they operate on your brain? That's my whole thing, you know, alcohol. It used to sort of be neat as a little formula, but, you know, that's the thing. There's just no way to...
So at this point, the only way to sell marijuana is to get a license through the Cannabis Coalition, which doesn't exist yet. So no one can sell marijuana except for... So that's for medical marijuana.
Okay. Oh, there's like a difference? Like,
yes. So the reason this law, I think there were like four different versions of the law that were proposed. And the only reason this one passed is because it allows the already existing dispensaries first chance at a license to sell marijuana legally.
For like
so,
a medical condition?
For recreation. So like we already have a dispensary in Northampton that dispenses for medical marijuana only, because that's the only way you can do it right now. But once everything gets going and we do have regulations for it, the law is written that I think there's 35 dispensaries in Massachusetts, that those 35 are first dibs to get a license for
recreation.
You mean like just selling some dope small off the street just for no medical reason?
Correct.
Like Colorado.
Yes.
And the problem right now is the weed that everyone's getting is not regulated. It's not, you know, it's like moonshine. You know, you don't know how intense the moonshine is going to be.
That's
it's not regulated.
Difficult with the whole processing of the body and the whole level.
So you could smoke a joint and I could smoke a joint. And because we bought it from two different people, and because, you know, my guy takes, you know, does more investing into it, or I spent more money and bought better weed, my high could last longer than yours. And could be more intense than yours.
Yeah.
Can I complicate this even further?
Sure.
The other thing too is we keep talking about smoking it, but one of the more popular ways of teaching it in now is through concentrates. So
is that like ingesting? Like
yes.
In
yep.
or something?
So you can there's the weed that he was talking about where the THC level has gone up is because of good growing practices. But then what people are doing with the marijuana is they can either cook it down to an oil. And when they do that, the oil can be used in lots of different applications. You can vape it, you can bake with it, you can make candies out of it. And that when you're doing that, it almost needs to be classified as a different drug because the THC is reaching levels of 80% now.
Sometimes it is classified as a different drug.
So it's just a whole nother, and it comes in all these different forms. Like there's waxes.
Can you accidentally eat something?
The edibles is really tricky. That's why they've kind of slowed down this, like rolling out the commercial side of it, is because they still haven't figured out, all right, if you're selling gummy bears, like how are you going to, like maybe the packaging will be unique, but what happens when you go home? Like if you don't eat the whole bag or you're trying to miss a block, how do you store that? Like there's just lots of things that they haven't.
Gummy bears?
Yeah. Well, because some of the formats, to be fair...
Brownies, cookies, lollipops.
Yeah. I mean, to be fair to the original intent, like originally the formats for candy were designed for people in hospice care, like so people who were going through chemo or something like that and had a lot of nausea. If you could suck on a lozenge with THC, it would give them a lot of relief. But like anything, you know, it has a recreational side, and so people are like, it's fun to eat and I get high, you know, but it can be very confusing for children. There's been dogs get into it, you know, there's all sorts of implications. So when you're talking about driving time and smoking, then yeah, it gets, when you eat it, it also takes a lot, it stays in your system a lot longer and you have a different type of high. So it's just really complicated to try to, so I think that's why his best piece of advice is like, if you're impaired, don't drive. Like if you're doing something that is...
What do you tell your kid about if somebody is giving them a gummy bear
though? Jeez. Watch them open the package and see where it came from.
Do kids do that? I mean, yes. You know, I remember like, here, you want an hour later? That was our like currency back in middle school, you know?
Yeah. When I was in college, we used to do the thing where you bought the sugar-free gummy bears, the ones that really gave you intestinal distress. We used to mix them in with regular gummy bears and like put them out.
What?
it's a sick trick that we used to do.
Sugar-free gummy bears?
Sugar-free gummy bears. If you go on Amazon.com, look up sugar-free gummy bears.
It just sounds like something a diabetic would.
And read the reviews on it. It's some of the most horrific experiences you can experience in your life.
Yeah.
Yes, because people will eat too many. No, it just gives you intestinal distress, for lack of better terminology.
There's a lot of fake sugars that the old-fashioned stuff that was used for diabetics probably 20 years ago that's still used in some products that will give most people gastrointestinal distress.
You
can't process it, and it gives you heart pain and all kinds of problems. So
if like blockage and stuff?
No, but just speeds everything up.
Opposite of blockage.
Speeds everything up. So
that's terrible.
I can see where maybe a college-age kid might see this as funny. Now you have to worry. It's
Harry Potter, you know.
Every flavor beans.
Every flavor beans. We put them in with regular jelly beans and funnel. Like, why do they taste one? It tasted like grass. Like, literally, it tasted like what I imagine grass. It tastes like boogers or something like that.
Yeah. Bean Boozled is the new game. It's sold in a box like jelly beans, and you just rotate it. You know, you dump a bean out, and it looks, you know, on the back, it's like, this could be strawberry shortcake, or it could be, you know, raw fish, or, you know, or stinky fish, or this could be vanilla cupcake, or it could be rotten egg. And it looks the same.
Right.
But, you know, there are kids at parties who will take the THC-laced candies and put it in a bowl and mix it in and, you know, put it out there. And
wow, what if somebody's like allergic? Like, you're not even thinking, I wouldn't even put, you know what I mean, like mixed peanuts in with, like, just thinking.
Because you're over the age of 24 and your brain is fully developed and your filter has fully been developed and you're able to think through complex situations like that. And again, with all due respect to my young people in the crowd, they can't. Sometimes they do, you know, and they'll surprise you, but a lot of times it's just not there.
Well, it's good that you're talking about the consequence of these actions, because with so many young people, they think, this is a good idea.
Yeah.
And they don't think the second part two. So if you have that discussion with your kids, well, what would happen if you encounter this or you participate in this? What's going to happen to your friends? It's always good to talk about part two. And that's what we try to emphasize at court in dealing with kids. And I always describe juvenile court as, it seemed like a good idea at the time. So just part two is your job as a parent. And
we hear that a lot in juvenile court. Why did you do this? It seemed like a good idea at the time. I could have told you, cement is stronger than you. That shopping cart's going to go a lot faster than you think it's going to go. And you shouldn't have gotten into it.
See, watch your YouTube videos, and a lot of the kids get hurt or that, like, that home funny home video stuff. But, like, sometimes that stuff gives people ideas, too. You know what I mean? Like,
well, like the challenges and stuff like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, like, you know, you see this kid, like, doing, like, some skateboarding off of all these rails and stuff. And I'm glad that YouTube shows, like, I mean, I don't like to see somebody get hurt, but, like, the reality of it is
you know, there's a lot of serious injury that can occur. Unfortunately, people seem to think that's funny and they put it on America's Funniest Videos, which I don't understand that, but it's deemed funny unless the person, you know, I guess has a serious injury. Now, that's all I'm thinking, like, that, how could that be funny? But that seems to be our culture, that those types of things are funny.
Like the knife challenge thing where like someone's like, oh, it's a smart idea, and I'm like, stick it in between my fingers. Oh, I don't have a finger anymore.
Correct.
Yeah, it's full of interesting
things. So what do you say to kids that say, oh, that will never happen to me, and do you think I'm stupid, and do you think my friends are bad, and you know, like, you know, you're just trying to warn them what's out there, you're trying to give that education, and they come back at you like, oh, what do you think, I'm stupid? Oh, I'm not stupid, you know. How do you, what do you say to them?
That's a great, great question.
Because
so what I would say to a parent who's in my office saying, you know, listen, how do I approach this with my kid? Because they're, you know, whatever, you would say, you know, if your kid's been a good kid, you know, and it looks like your kid's a pretty good kid. So if your kid's been a good kid for, you know, never made decisions like this, or maybe once in a while, you say, you know, normally you make good decisions, you know, and I'm really proud of the way you've been acting, and I'm really proud of the way you represent me and your friends and your school and everything else while you're out there. This is just one thing that I'm concerned about, you know, that I heard about, I learned about, I read about, you know, I found out about, you know, just one thing I'm nervous about. And I, as a parent, it's my job to make sure that I educate you to things that you may not get at school, you know, and this is one of those things I just wanted to talk to you about. Normally you make really good decisions. I'm really proud of the person you are right now. And I just want to see you continue and be able to move on and be successful and do whatever you want to do. And I'm afraid that if you got involved in something like this, that may take away from whatever you wanted to do.
They're so offended, they see it so as a judgment on their character, et cetera, and you're just trying to give them the information that you yourself may not have chosen to eat gummy bears laced with whatever, but this is out there, you know, and this is something that you need to be aware of.
So I'm guilty of it. I mean, I have a 6 and an 8-year-old, so it's really hard to do what I'm about to tell you to do, but with teenagers, it's better if you talk with them than to them. So instead of turning it into a lecture about this is what's going on, this is what's wrong, this is what could happen, don't you understand, this is what's going on, look at these videos, look at these statistics. Yes, you know, and my 8-year-old, it's like, why did you do that? You know you're going to break this, you know you're going to hit your brother, he's going to cry, you know your mother's going to yell at you, and you know I'm going to get in trouble for letting you do it, you know. So instead of talking to them like that, the teenagers, you really need to sit down. And again, that's why I say it's better if when they come home from a party that you talk to them in the morning, because you're cool, you're level-headed, you've had time to think about what you want to say and the points you want to bring up. They're sober, they're done with the, you know, the whole defensive thing, they're home, they're safe. Because if you try to talk to them that night, they're going to be defensive because they're nervous, they're going to think you're judging them. You know, you're going to start picking on their friends and being that, and you're emotional. Regardless of how anyone tells me, you know, no, I'm pretty cool, I'm a cool parent. No, you're emotional. At 2:30 in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, when you show up to pick your kids up in your pajamas, your flip-flops, and, your tank top, whatever you're in, and, you know, the words out of your mouth are, get in the car. Is she in trouble? No, she's not in trouble. Get in the car. You're emotional. Okay.
You're also assuming that the next day morning we're not going to be emotional.
You will be less emotional.
That's an assumption.
It is an assumption, but statistically you're more apt to be level-headed at that point. But then again, like I'm saying, you got to talk with them.
Whatever bad thing happened is not worse, I guess. That's what you should think of, that your kid is still alive and whatever happened, deal with.
Right. And you, overnight, you have time to think. You may not sleep that night because of all the emotion, all the energy you've got going through your head, but you'll start thinking, you know, at least they made it home. At least they didn't get in a car with someone and get in a car accident. I've lost good friends of mine from high school who got in the car with someone who was drinking. He survived and killed 3 of my best friends. You know, so it hits home. You know, and a lot of these kids, when I talk to them here at school, you know, or even in the middle school when I worked there, but most of these kids in high school are the ones that are out doing this partying. When they come in on Monday morning, and I have, even after I've talked to the assistant principal, I've talked to the athletic director, I've done all I need to do, and I have their name on a report, they will stop by my office and, are you mad at me? I'm not mad at you. Sit down, talk. Let's, you know,
what was going on?
Do you have an office here? Is that what
I do. Yep, I have an office here. Yeah, and I'm here Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. On Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'm at JFK.
Yeah, I don't know.
But they'll come in, and the first words out of their mouth are, you're going to be mad at me, or you're mad at me. And I go, I'm never going to be mad at you unless you call me a bad name. Then we're going to have issues. You know, and they'll smile, they'll laugh, and I go, sit down, let's talk. You know, and some of them, I've had them come in and go, you're going to be mad at me. Why? You know, you got caught in East Hampton with some weed. I didn't even know you got caught in East Hampton. But I can play it off like I did. Be like, yeah, I know, they called me. They told me. Yeah. You know, and they're like, oh, stupid, I was out with some friends. You know, they tell you the whole story, and you go, listen, you know, and I have one kid right now who comes to me all the time. My parents are mean, they're jerks, they're this, they're that. And I'm like, why are they jerks? I snuck out, and when I was coming back, my father was awake, and he grounded me, and I'm like, serious? You think that's being a mean parent? I'm like, you probably scared the daylights out of him when he woke up, and you were gone, and then all of a sudden a cab pulls up, and you're getting out of the cab. I'm like, where were you that you had to take a cab? You know, that's not a mean parent. That's someone who cares about you, but they don't see, you're right, they don't see it that way. They see the parent who stayed up and talked to him that night. When they came home, high or drunk or maybe nothing, but just having broken the rules, they come home that night and the parent confronted her, and that's all she knows. That's what she took out of that, was that my father woke up, I wasn't home, he stayed up and waited for me to get home like a psycho, and I'm like a psycho? Like a parent. Like, you want to know what will happen if my kid sneaks out? I won't be staying at home. You can bet that. I'll be in my car driving around looking for him. You know, but, you know, that's what they see, because they walked in the door, yeah, just like Uncle Buck. You know, they walk through the door, there's the father, click, on goes the single light, he's sitting in the recliner, no TV on, like any parent would sit waiting up with no TV on, but, you know, on goes the light, there's the dad, where have you been? You know, it doesn't go like that. You know how any parent would be, where have you been? I've been up worried, blah, 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 blah. I woke your mother up, which probably isn't a good idea. You know, and, you know, screaming at the kid.
She can fall asleep, right?
Yeah.
The mother's just completely awake because she's worried.
Yeah.
That would be me.
But that's what this girl relayed to me as the scenario. You know, and ever since then, and that's been a couple weeks ago, we've had a couple issues where we've gotten called to the house because the parents get up in the middle of the night checking, she's gone again. And they call us and they're coming back. And what is she doing? She's out with a guy she likes. Yeah, they smoked a little weed, they hung out, but her parents don't approve of him, so she has to sneak out to see him. And he can't drive either, so she sneaks out, she calls an Uber, takes an Uber at 16, not even 16, she's 14, takes an Uber to this kid's house to hang out with him, comes back, takes the Uber back, you know, very, very risky behavior. And what does she get out of everything? My father's crazy because he sits at night and waits up for me to get home and then screams at me when I walk in the door. I'm not saying it would be different. I'm not saying it would be better. I'm not saying I have the magic book to raising kids, because I definitely don't, if you met my two. But, you know, waiting till the morning to talk to the kids. When you're calm, you're cool, just be glad they're home and say, where were you last night? I was really nervous.
Oh,
you know,
it
was really not, you know, not cool. Like, I was nervous, your mom was nervous. You know, this is unacceptable, this can't happen. Like, I don't know what to tell you, you know, what's going on. You know, it's my job to keep you safe and you're sneaking out. I don't know where you are. If you're gonna go out, at least let me know you're going out. You know, at least talk to me so I know where you are. You know, keep your cell phone on, answer your cell phone when I call you. She knew enough to shut her cell phone off so he couldn't track her. You know, and so just imagine being that parent. Your 14-year-old daughter is gone. No idea where she is. Phone's going right to voicemail. Phone's off. Can't track her. Can't figure it out. All of a sudden, an Uber pulls up. She hops out like it's 5 o'clock on a Sunday. She just got home from church.
So you can't tell them. You don't know.
And they won't talk to you if they think everything you do is going to be adversarial and judgmental. But I get them coming into my office. Officer Wallace, you're going to be mad at me. I did this. I did that. And I'm not saying I do everything right, but it's because I don't yell at them. I don't judge them. I tell them right off, I'm never going to be mad at you. I'm glad you told me what you did. Do you understand? You know, and I'll talk to them a little bit, and then I'll say, do you understand what, you know, what you're doing, what you're putting your parents through? Like, you know, imagine this. Imagine that. Imagine this is your kid. Imagine you woke up in the middle of the night and your parents aren't home. You know, imagine it. You know, you woke up in the middle of the night and you go looking around and your parents are gone. You have no idea where they are. They didn't leave a note. You try to call them, they aren't answering their phones. Imagine that. You know, put yourself in their shoes.
That's what I'm saying. I try to be like reciprocal, respectful. I don't make the rules just for you. I do the same. You know, you always know where I am.
But then every kid should not have a smartphone.
Well, if they don't, then how do you track them?
So, my 8-year-old has started to ask me when he's going to get a cell phone, and I said, you can get a cell phone and get your license and you're driving your car without me and your mom in it. And even then, I'm going to give you the free phone from AT&T, that's the flip phone. And I'm going to take it and I'm going to program it so that you hold down number 1 to call mom, hold down number 2 to call dad, hold down number 3 to call home. Then I'm going to take the rest of the numbers and pop them all out so you can't dial anything else but 1, 2, 3. So when you get a phone, it's going to have a red button, a green button, and 1, 2, and 3, and that's all you're going to get. There'll be no texting. There'll be no calling anybody else. You know, people can call you. Yeah?
No, to speak on the phone, sometimes I wish I had my flip phone. I had like a little keyboard and like, I wish I could go back to that.
See? I'm doing him a favor.
That could be arranged.
It's like nice and clicky and small.
Yeah, see? Retro is cool now.
Yeah, I think that's probably me. I have a flip phone now. That's the all that.
You got a question?
Yeah, it's about adults. I don't drink at all. I've actually never had a drink in my entire life. And so I really don't get the appeal of alcohol. So I'm just curious why when I go out with people that drink and like, I know that some people get cut off eventually, but like why are they even allowed off, to get to them? I'm sorry?
If they're getting cut off, that's a problem.
Right, but that doesn't always happen across the board. So I'm just wondering, like, if it's illegal to drive drive like that, like, why did... I know it's probably because they just want to make money, but I just don't understand why the world is set up the way it is. Like, why aren't you just allowed to buy one drink?
It is illegal for a bartender to overserve you.
But nobody's really watching them, right?
We are.
Well, you're not in every bar every night.
No, so what happens for us is, say I stop you, and I know you don't drink, but I'm going to use you as an example. I stop you, I run you through OUI, I arrest you for OUI. One of the questions I'm going to ask you is, where are you coming from? Where were you drinking? That last drink report goes into a file.
Okay.
So many bars have last drink reports. You know, like, you know, Joe's Bar and Grill, you know, in downtown Northampton, everyone keeps coming from there, and we keep stopping for OUIs, or, you know, we keep having fights with people. Yeah. We keep having these really intoxicated people. We'll start doing more compliance checks. We do compliance checks, and we check every bar in Northampton.
Okay.
On the weekend. Every bar gets checked.
Oh, wow. Months. Well, what brought this up is I went to, like, you know, see two friends, and one of them, by the time I got there, like, she couldn't stand up. She couldn't walk. Like, guys were groping her. It was really obvious, and I, you know, I think they cut her off by then, but, like, what the heck? Like, I just, to me, she was in a state of medical health. Like, she couldn't stand up by herself. I was, like... this goes to calling
me. So I bartended through college. That's how I made my money.
Okay.
And it was, you know, one of the things you had to watch out for was not only the people who were really drunk, but especially the girls who were really drunk, and then the guys who want to keep buying them drinks.
Yeah.
Just so you know, it's really difficult being the one single bartender with 40 people.
Oh, yeah.
You know, on a slow night, 40 people at my bar.
Yeah.
And trying to serve everybody and do it, you know. I get better tips if you get your drink faster, and it's right. So, you know, there's pressure on me to serve the people fast, make sure I, you know, the boss is watching to make sure I'm making change right, I'm charging people the right thing. You know, if I use the nice liquor, I got to charge you more. If I use the regular liquor, I charge you less. And, you know, and if people, you know, just managing all that can be really difficult. So I used to have a black magic marker, and I used to just say, oh, can I see your hand? I'd put an X right on your hand. And that way I would know, you know, I'm not serving you anymore. But the problem I would run into, and this was in Beverly, Massachusetts, would be, you know, they'd come back and be like, you sir, over-served her. I'm like, oh, no, I didn't. I put an X on her hand. I stopped serving her.
But somebody else.
Somebody else was buying her drinks and bringing it to her and bringing it to the other side of the bar and letting her drink out of that.
So I get that that could still happen. I was just wondering why it's not. Why there's no restriction, like more restrictions, like you're only allowed to have one drink when you come to a bar. Like, I don't know.
I think bartenders do have a hard job, you know, because they have to make all these calls and determinations, and people get really obstinate about it, and there's just too many variables. Like,
don't they close early up here?
Sometimes,
yeah.
No, they close on time. 587-1100 is our dispatch. If you want to get in touch with me, and then when you call there, they're going to say, what's up with public safety? What's your emergency? Can I talk to Officer Wallace? Can I leave him a voicemail? His extension 3307. They know that. You can also call the high school, and there's an option to be directed to the school resource officer. That'll leave me a voicemail on there. I also, it's better off emailing me because I never know where I'm going to be. And that's just jwallace, W-A-L-L-A-C-E, at northamptonma.gov. And I answer that on the weekends pretty regularly, as long as my phone's working and you're not from the district attorney's office.
So what do you do to make your presence more known in the school?
I walk around, I come down to lunch, I talk to kids, I go into some classes, I go to sporting events.
Northampton High School hasn't mandated any social host training yet, so the organization I work for is the Northampton Prevention Coalition, so we're just trying to fill the gap, but we can't mandate it. So we always offer food and try to get parents and teens to come together, and this is the second year that we've offered this, and we usually get about the same amount of showing. So I think our next step is to try to work with the athletic director and see if we can get time into one of her mandated presentations to offer this. But I did want to say before we break up that if you want to give us feedback on our evaluation, that helps us fine-tune these programs, so there should be some on the tables. And if you're a parent or guardian that lives in Northampton, I also have these out here. If you live in Northampton and you're a parent, you're going to get a postcard from us soon, which is going to be our way of collecting data on parents. Like, it asks about your perceptions around alcohol and drugs and underage use, and also just some other questions about just basic information. So I'm just going to leave these here. You can go to the survey. Yeah.
And you said you were going to get something in the mail?
We're going to be sending out postcards, but I figured since I had a captive audience here, I would at least start sharing the link. But if you want to take it now, it's open, it's live, and if you want to be entered into the raffle that we're offering for a $100 gift card, you just have to leave your contact info at the end
of the
survey. So the
postcard we're getting is the same as the...
The same exact thing, yep.
Can I take out my hair?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming. And thank you, Officer Wallace, for answering those questions.
Thank you.